iBank Trioval. The CART Indy cars are here for a 150-mile dash. For the command to start engines, here is Gene Earhart, the Vice President and General Manager of the Detroit News.
Of the Detroit News.
Gentlemen,
start your engines.
26 cars are firing to life, 75 laps, 150 miles, as ESPN presents live the Detroit News Grand Prix from Michigan International Speedway near Jackson, Michigan. Racing 82 is brought to you by Pennzoil, makers of Penn Motor Oil, quality in every extra mile. And by Timex, timekeeper to ESPN. Timex, we make technology beautiful. It's a very cloudy day in the southern hills of Michigan and also some fog earlier today. Yesterday we had rain. We do not expect any today. We have 64 degrees of temperature, the wind at 3 miles an hour, and a little more than a 30% chance of rain today. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Jenkins. This is Larry Neuber. We're set for a 150-mile Indianapolis-type car race here today. And in the qualifying yesterday, the speeds were higher than they were earlier this year here at this racetrack, as Rick Mears exceeded 206 miles an hour in going for the pole position. Three names come to mind here this afternoon: Rick Mears, A.J. Foyt, and Mario Andretti.
Well, Bob, certainly if there is a favorite, it has to be Rick Mears. He has won four times in the 1982 Championship Car Trail. He has led almost half of the total laps, 770 out of 1,428 laps of competition. He has been over 200 miles per hour all week long here at practice at the Michigan International Speedway. And if there is a favorite going in, it has to be Rick Mears. A.J. Foyt, who finished second earlier this season at Milwaukee, comes in here not as a dark horse, certainly. You can never call Foyt as a dark horse, but it's been quite some time since A.J. has won on the IndyCar Trail. The last time here at the Michigan International Speedway, A.J. Foyt may have been the fastest car on the racetrack before being involved in a crash. And then Mario Andretti. Andretti is hungry for victory. He has finished second three times this year. He flew overnight from Las Vegas to compete here after running in a Formula One race yesterday there. Andretti has been added to the field as a promoter's choice, promoter's option. He starts in the very tail end of the field, last position. Bob and I will be up top covering all of the action for you, and down on pit road, they're expected to stop at least once, maybe twice, Gary Lee.
If you like to put your money on consistency, keep an eye on the rookie starting in row number three, Bobby Rahal, car number 19. He is second in the point standings because of that consistency. He's a road racer that has adapted quickly to the ovals. A third here in the Michigan 500, a second at Milwaukee, one victory on the road course. Keep an eye on Bobby Rahal today and in the future.
Bobby Rahal in the red roofs in number 19 out there on the speedway, and we are ready now to bring you the starting lineup for today's race. In the front row, Rick Mears from Bakersfield, California in the Gould Charge. He qualified at 206.416. Alongside in the front row, his teammate, Kevin Cogan from Redondo Beach, California in the Norton Spirit, 202.851. In the second row, A.J. Foyt from Houston, Texas, in the Valvoline Gilmore, 202.276. And alongside the winner of the Indy 500 and the 500 here earlier this year, Gordon John Frockcock from nearby Coldwater, Michigan. Then Bobby Rahal from Columbus, Ohio, in the Red Roofs in March. He qualified at 201.3. And alongside him will be Pancho Carter from Brownsburg, Indiana, driving the Alex Food March, 200.809. The rest of the starting lineup in the fourth row, will be Mike Mosley in car number 18, the Krako car stereo, and Tom Sneba in car number 7 in the Texaco Star. In the fifth row, car number 10, Allen Zer from Albuquerque, New Mexico in the Longhorn Racing, and Tony Bettenhausen in car number 6 in the Provimi Veal March. In the sixth row, car number 36, Scott Brayton from Coldwater, Michigan in the Driesbach Cadillac, and Jose Legarza, car number 55, in the Schlitz Gusto. Seventh row, Roger Mears, car number 31, and Bill Alsop in car number 2. In the eighth row will be Jerry Sneva in 86 and Tom Bigelow in 72. The ninth row consists of Chip Ganassi in car number 12 and Dick Ferguson in number 11. In the 10th row, Gary Bettenhausen, car 56, Dick Simon in 22. In the 11th row will be Greg Loeffler in car number 64 and Howdy Holmes in number 30. In the 12th row will be Mario Andretti in car number 40 and Jeff Brabham in number 21. Finally, in the 13th row will be Phil Krueger in car number 65. Now, the driver who was supposed to start in the 4th row this afternoon was Johnny Rutherford, but this is what happened on his second lap of qualifying in turn number 3 yesterday.
Well, Rutherford had already qualified fast enough to get into the field. You can see how violent that crash was. We're going to have a replay for you in slow motion to get an idea of what happened. Johnny hauls her down into turn number 3. The car appears simply to get away from him. They're not absolutely certain whether or not something broke or he just lost it. The car has not made any contact with anything yet. That's just the air that's hitting that car improperly. Of course, the cars are designed to go forward, all the aerodynamics, and just the violence of the air at almost 200 miles an hour begins to rip the bodywork away from that car even before it makes contact. He made contact with the left rear quarter panel, and Johnny's head came very close to hitting that outside retaining wall. But Johnny Rutherford was not injured, and they've elected not to start today, even though they had a backup car on the grounds.
Needless to say, the car was badly damaged. They did have a backup here, but they decided not to go with it. Dick Ferguson in car number 11 is on pit road. He is not out there in the starting lineup. Work being done on that car. Meanwhile, the field is entering turn number 3 now, and we anticipate a green flag this next time around. This is a 150-mile race, 75 laps, and there also is Johnny Parsons in car number 34. We had been warned earlier that Johnny may not be able to start this race. He had engine problems late yesterday afternoon, and so is not on the grid at this time. The cars come off of turn number 4 onto the tri-oval, and the green flag is out. The Detroit News 150-mile Grand Prix for Indianapolis-type cars is underway. Into turn number 1. Now, the turns here at Michigan International Speedway are banked at 18 degrees. They come off of the 18-degree banking onto the backstretch, which is relatively flat, as they race down the backstretch here on lap number 1. Rick Mears, and Mears has a problem as the car apparently blew an engine just as he was about to enter turn number 3. Rick Mears got off into the lead as the green flag came out, but you can see the smoke pouring from that engine, and Rick Mears' hand went up suddenly at the end of the backstretch. He drops down low. The first lap is complete, meanwhile, as we continue to watch Rick Mears coming into the pit area. The leader is Kevin Kogan in car number 4, followed by A.J. Foyt. Mario Andretti, who started in the rear of the pack, has already begun his move. He has passed 6 cars already and is moving up quickly.
Well, there, I believe, is Gary Bettenhausen, also started near the back of this pack. He started back in that area where Andretti was, and Bettenhausen has also improved his position a little bit as he moved towards the front. There is Mario Andretti, who started near Gary but continues to move to the front very rapidly. Remember, this is the second time that Mario has been in this position this year. By the way, that white orange trim car that you just got a glimpse of is Jerry Sneva. I know it's Al Acquasto's number 86, but that's the Hoffman team that has entered here this weekend with Jerry Sneva at the controls.
And so the other Penske car, driven by Kevin Kogan, is in the lead right now. We have completed 2 laps, and the yellow is out at Michigan International Speedway. The safety trucks move out onto the race course. We will be getting a report as to why we are yellow at this point. Rick Mears with some tough luck as the car blew an engine at the end of the backstretch on the very first lap. Here the cars come down in front of us on the tri-oval as the yellow flag is displayed. Kevin Kogan followed by A.J. Foyt, then Gordon Johncock. Bobby Rahal running fourth. In fifth position is the number 3 car, driven by Pancho Carter. The word from the championship auto racing teams is that there is debris on the track, and there is the piece of debris that the kart officials have already retrieved and will be going back green in just a moment. We will return for more live coverage of the Detroit News Grand Prix in a moment. Five laps have been completed, and Mario Andretti has moved from his 23rd starting position already up to 15th. Yesterday in Las Vegas, Nevada, Mario participated in a Grand Prix, and things did not go real well for Mario there, as has been the case many times. He hit the wall at Las Vegas, and it eliminated him from the competition.
Bob, there's been a lot of talk about what Mario's plans are for next year, and as best as we could discern, trying to do some reporting work here in the pits yesterday, obviously he was not here at Michigan, but there really isn't anything official. He has a lot of options, apparently, that are open and available to him, but Andretti has been very loyal to the kart series this year, and despite the handicap of having started way back in last, he went to a lot of effort to get to this race here to compete at Michigan International Speedway this afternoon.
Pace car is accelerating and pulling off of the racetrack, and the field also begins to accelerate off of turn number four onto the Tri-Oval, where several thousand people have gathered today to watch this race in very cool weather. The green flag is back out and racing once again at Michigan International. Now A.J. Foyt, moving high on the racetrack, is challenging Kevin Kogan for the lead in turns one and two. 18 degrees of banking. They're going well over 200 miles an hour at some points on this racetrack. Kevin Kogan is able to hold off the challenge of A.J. Foyt, at least for the time being, as the cars flash down the backstretch. Now setting up for, once again, 18-degree banking in turns number three and four. There is Kevin Kogan, the leader of this race. He started in second position. Now they move off of turn number four. Notice how high the cars are as they come off of turn number four in front of the main grandstand of the start-finish line. Seven laps have been completed. Kevin Kogan running first. It is A.J. Foyt running second. Then a bit of racetrack before we get back to the third place car of Gordon Johncock. Bobby Rahal is running fourth. It is Pancho Carter running in fifth position, and in sixth is Al Unser. A tough break for Rick Mears. Our pole sitter, Gary Lee, is with him.
Rick Mears, no warning.
No warning at all. Evidently we just broke a rod or something and just spit her out the bottom of the motor. I really don't know, because usually if you lose a rod bearing or something like that,
you pulled down
trouble
low to get out of the groove.
Yeah.
And we have a bad crash in turn number one as the leaders, Kevin Kogan and A.J. Foyt, got together. Larry?
Well, they were side by side as they went into turn number two. Foyt, I believe, was on the inside. I was watching it, not on the monitor, but across the turn number one. You see A.J. out of the racetrack. He went into the wall very hard, as did Kevin. There was a great deal of fire when the cars first hit the cement. But again, repeating, I believe that A.J. was on the inside, Kevin on the outside. They were very close the last lap around when the roles were reversed with A.J. on the high side.
And well, Larry, there was a lot of fire from the accident. Now, there is no fire right now, as the safety mechanisms built into these cars obviously work. The safety crews have gone to the rescue of A.J. Foyt. He was able to climb out of his car. His car is on the outside of the track, whereas Kevin Kogan's car has slid to the inside, and the safety crews are also there with him. We'll go back and take a look at what happened in turn number one. There you can see it is Foyt low and Kogan high.
And they're side by side, and it's pretty difficult to ascertain exactly who had the line, but judge for yourself. You see them heading towards the wall. They've scuffed off maybe 40 miles an hour, 150, 160 mile an hour collision right there with cement wall, and the wall remains undefeated.
Larry, it looked like that perhaps A.J. made tougher contact with Kogan's car than he made with the outside wall, from that angle at least.
Well, Foyt is already moving around inside the race car. I think A.J. may have been a little concerned over fire at that point. Foyt was wrestling to get out even before the car stopped. There is A.J. Foyt heading back to the hospital. And now A.J. is having a conversation with Kevin Kogan. Kevin still in his helmet and A.J. pointing back toward the place where the crash began. And now Kevin and A.J. getting a little more close as they discuss the accident situation. But both drivers out of the race cars walking around on the inside of the crash scene. The cars ended up over near turn number two, having collided with the outside wall midway between 1 and 3. So three of the truly pre-race favorites in this event are gone before we completed lap number 10, incidentally, as we watch this conversation. Andretti also ducked into the pits during this caution flag. This figures to be a long caution flag. There's going to be a lot of debris on the racetrack.
Once again, we have fingers being shaken at Kevin Kogan. Of course, he was involved in the first lap altercation at the Indianapolis 500, which eliminated himself and Mario Andretti. And now A.J. Foyt is shaking his finger and having a tough discussion with Kevin in turn number one as their cars got together on the ninth lap of this 150-mile race at Michigan International Speedway. So the yellow is out, the debris being picked up from the accident in turn number one. Both drivers are out of their cars. They're talking to each other. They appear to be okay. Back with more live coverage from Michigan International after these messages. Back at Michigan International Speedway, where we are under caution because of an accident involving A.J. Foyt and Kevin Kogan, we're using a radar gun to time the cars as they come off of the tri-oval into turn number one, and the radar gun caught A.J. Foyt and Kevin Kogan traveling at 211 miles an hour, seconds before they were involved in that altercation.
Yeah, we'd like to thank Scott Brayton and his racing team out of Coldwater, Michigan, for the use of that gun. Scott came with a sponsor specifically for this race, the Driesby Cadillac people. There is A.J. Foyt's race car. You can see the right front, the point of contact with Roger Penske and Kevin Kogan's machine, pretty badly damaged, and the singe from the flash fire that occurred when the two cars collided with the outside retaining wall. A.J., of course, has been involved in a crash earlier this year here at the Michigan International Speedway, so this racetrack has not treated him particularly well in the 1982 season. Also, he has been burned on a couple of occasions, so that was the reason for that comment. He might have been concerned about that fire. He was once burned at DuCoin in refueling of a dirt car and also in an IndyCar crash several years back.
Well, Kevin Kogan is out of the race, and we had a chance to talk with Kevin yesterday during the practice and the qualifications, and we asked him if it's difficult to handle all that's said and written about him.
Well, I think that the part that's missed really is what I've done. You know, what qualify on the pole, break track records, qualify on the front row the rest of the time, lots of times, and run well in the race. And it's really a shame, you know, because what do you got to do? What do I have to do? You know, I've done nothing wrong. I didn't do anything wrong, and I've done nothing wrong since. But people just, you know, they won't let you forget.
Word is that A.J. Foyt is limping a little bit. We'll have a specific report on that a little bit later from the track hospital. We continue to run under caution. We have completed 13 laps now. The leader is Poncho Carter in car number three. Running in second position is Scott Brayton. Third is Roger Mears. Fourth place belongs to Gary Bettenhausen. In fifth place, the number 72 car driven by Tom Bigelow. Several of those cars, however, have not pitted during this caution period. Mario Andretti and Gordon Johncock have both been in. They are running sixth and seventh. This is going to be a lengthy yellow. You can see the skid marks that lead to the outside retaining wall. It's going to be a lengthy yellow because a tremendous amount of debris and liquid was laid down on the racetrack. So the crews are up there putting down the oil dry and the other absorbent materials so that we can get going green here in just a few more laps.
Well, again, we've had many of the top drivers knocked out already.
And once again, as we have completed 13 laps, it is Carter, Brayton, and Mears in that order.
The last thing
it's very difficult to tell exactly what happened, but Kevin Kogan and A.J. Foyt are running side by side for the lead on lap number 9 when something happened.
Well, both cars are in the middle of the racetrack, and all of a sudden they seem to go together. They get very close, and there they touch. And boy, Bob, that is one tough call. The cars make second contact. Unfortunately, Kevin going sideways like that did scuff off a lot of speed, and then they drill into that outside retaining wall, and Kevin sandwiched between AJ's right front and the outer retaining wall. There's the oil fire and the fire from the fuel, basically that is in the lines running from the fuel cell. One of the tires almost going over the wall. Most of that fire from the lines that are in the lines from the fuel back to the engine compartment as it lights up all of the component parts. Of course, the
fuel that these cars burn, that doesn't necessarily light up, but it catches all the other parts on fire. The oil that is in the engine also covers a lot of the debris that is being spread around the racetrack, but fortunately it snuffs out pretty quickly in a modern-day Indianapolis car accident.
Well, there's A.J. Foyt's battered Valvoline Gilmore car, and Gary Lee has made his way to the track hospital. We'll be getting an official report on the condition of the drivers, but preliminary reports are that both of them are okay, although A.J. Foyt apparently was limping when he got out of that race car. And we do have a further update now from Gary Lee.
We're standing outside the infield hospital where both A.J. and Kevin Cogan have been taken. A.J. was limping noticeably as he walked in, but he was walking under his own power. The preliminary report is both drivers are okay.
It's been a tough year for A.J. Foyt here at Michigan International Speedway. In the 500-mile race that was run here earlier, he had an altercation with Hector Rabaki right here on the tri-oval area in front of the main grandstand. Of course, he was very seriously injured at Michigan International last year. Now he returns to racing and another accident.
And certainly he came here with a great deal of enthusiasm, Bob. A.J. returned to the 1982 season with not vengeance as much, but he was very anxious to go racing, and certainly Lady Luck has not been on his side. He did have that second at Milwaukee after dropping out of the Indianapolis 500, and a pretty strong performance there. Transmission problems knocked him out of that race. He also raced at Cleveland as well as at Pocono and was a non-finisher in those two events.
Looking at this racetrack specifically now, as we indicated to you, it is a 2-mile D-shaped or tri-oval. The turns are 73 feet wide. The straightaways are 43 feet wide. Turns are banked at 18 degrees, and the straightaway 43 feet wide.
Michigan International Speedway was put together back in 1968. Ronnie Bucknam was the surprise winner of the inaugural race here.
And you know, the race in 1970, which is the first race I saw here, the accident that we just experienced with A.J. Foyt and Kevin Cogan was very reminiscent of an accident that occurred in 1970 here between Gary Bettenhausen and Gordon Johncock as those two cars were racing side by side. Gordy lost a wheel and hit the outside wall in turn number one. Gary went on to win that race back in 1970. At that time, they were running twin 200s during the season here at Michigan International, but in the past 2 years, they have run a 500-mile race here and then followed it up with this IndyCar race late in the season.
Most of the drivers will tell you that the Michigan International Speedway is one of the best engineered racetracks on the trail. It is 2 miles in length. The track is very wide for a track of its size, and all of the turns here have been designed with geometrics in mind. There was a lot of effort put forth, I believe, on some computer boards when this track was designed, and it's a track that most of the drivers, despite its very high speed, seem to like quite a lot.
Al Unser is the driver of the number 10 Longhorn car. He qualified at 197.168 miles an hour. The owner of the team that Al Unser has been driving for the past few years is Bobby Hillen. And we, of course, at this point in the season, are interested in who is going to be with what team next year and who will be changing their cars that they're driving this year. And a major announcement came from the Bobby Hillen stable yesterday. You can see there that Al Unser was a three-time Indianapolis 500 winner back in 1970, in 1971, and in 1978. As we indicated, Bobby Hillen made a major announcement here at Michigan International Speedway, and we had a chance to talk with Bobby and with Al Unser.
Certainly one of the premier teams of Indianapolis car racing the past couple of seasons has been the Bobby Hillen team with Al Unser the driver. But Bobby Hillen, you've got a major change to announce, do you not?
Yes, Larry. The conditions in the energy business, which is the business that I make my living in, are pretty depressed right now. And I've just made the decision that rather than put myself in a real bind, I'm going to sell the racing team and get out of racing for at least the time being. I hope not forever, because I really love racing and I really enjoyed it, and I don't regret a minute that I've spent in it. But we are going to try to sell Longhorn Racing. I think we've got it going where it's a real going enterprise now. We finally kind of turned the corner on the technological end of things, so we're going to put it on the block, and I won't be racing anymore.
That's an important word also, Bobby. You're selling the team. You're not dissolving the team. That's really a reflection of your feelings about Cardin, what's happening, isn't it?
Well, it really is. I would never have. I'm really hoping that there's no way we want to just dissolve this racing team, because we've spent a lot of time and money trying to get it to the point that we're at. As you know, we had the Elkhart race, Elkhart Lake race one last week, and I think we're pretty well there, you know, from that standpoint. So I think we've got something here that, from the technical end of it, with John Ward as chief designer and Wayne Leary, and of course, depending on what Al might want to do, he might elect to stay with Longhorn, or he might elect not to. You know, that's his decision. But I think we've got something here that's a real value to someone, and that's the way I want to do it, as opposed to just to Longhorn quitting racing. That's not the case at all. It's Bobby Hill I'm quitting.
Al, I saw you nod your head when Bobby said you made some real technical advances. The team was really beginning to come together as far as the road to victory, wasn't it?
Yes, it is. It's really a shame, but things like this happen once in a while, and I know he's not going to stay out of it because he loves racing, and he'll be back.
Journalists like to theory and like to start rumors, you might say, but in point of fact, at this point, with this announcement, your options are totally open. Is that correct?
Very much so. Yeah, I have to find a job for next year.
Bobby, you have got an interesting project starting back home. Young son, Bobby Hillen Jr. Any involvement, perhaps, in the future there?
No, Larry. Not other than an emotional involvement. He's my son, and much like Al feels about Al Jr., I'm hoping he does well. But this thing of his with the stock car racing has been his own doing all along. All I've done is give him a little encouragement, maybe a little guidance. But I do not plan to get actively involved in any kind of racing other than IndyCar racing ever.
Bobby, your decision to sell Longhorn Racing Team is certainly not a reflection on any concern you have for the future of CART. We're aware of that. You've shared that with us, right?
Oh, no. Quite the contrary. I think, CART was formed in 1979. With some goals and objectives that I think everyone is pretty familiar with by now, and I think it's right on course. I think that the most exciting motor racing in the world is right here at the PPG IndyCar World Series. We're bringing together now the road courses and the ovals, which I don't know if a lot of people have given that a lot of thought, but there's a lot. There are two different type fans in the United States, and we're bringing them all together here. We're going to have six or seven very, very unique road racing events at new circuits. They'll be announced probably within the next year or so, some things that are really going to be exciting. And I think CART is still in its infancy at where it's going, but I think the direction is correct, and it's going to be a heck of a good series for many years to come.
Still under yellow, we have completed 19 laps. Here are the top seven at this point. With the speed of the race, 134. Poncho Carter, the leader. Scott Brayton running second. Roger Mears is third. Tom Bigelow, fourth. Gordon Johncock is fifth. Mario Andretti running in sixth position. And Phil Kruger, car number 65, is in seventh. Work has been completed over in turn number two, and the pace car is pulling ahead of the field, indicating that we may be going green this time around. There was, as we indicated, a lot of debris up in that area. They had to lay down a lot of oil dry. They do have a jet engine that's used at this racetrack for drying purposes, and that jet engine was also used just a few minutes ago to blow away some of the smoke that would have been created by the cars running through that oil dry. Here's Gary Lee.
Kevin Kogan has been checked out. Physically, he is okay. Give us your assessment of what happened.
Well, it was fairly early in the race. I was leading the race going into turn one and taking my normal race line. And I know Foyt was behind me. The next thing I know, he had tried to make a pass down the straightaway, and it looked like he was dropping back. I took my normal line going into turn one, and next thing I know, I was sideways.
So it's just a case of two race cars being in the same groove.
I took my normal race line, and next thing I know, I'm sideways.
The car is damaged, but you physically, you're okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we're glad to hear that. A.J. Foyt, the report is that he has a bump on his left leg, will be taken to Foote Hospital for x-rays, but apparently the injury to Foyt is not real serious. Here is the completion of lap number 22, and the leader is Poncho Carter, and Mario Andretti has moved up to fourth position. Now, we understand that there are a lot of people in Caesar's Palace watching us today, bringing you this race live from Michigan International. We salute you. We also congratulate you on a fine race held at the Caesar's Palace Grand Prix yesterday.
There is Mario going to the inside of young Scott Brayton, one of the local drivers here. Scott has surprised a lot of people by doing well in Indianapolis in 1981. He's had a bit of a down season. Andretti goes by. Andretti has moved to third. He and Gordy Johncock, Gordy right there in front of him, the two STP twins, now run second and third. Pancho Carter has opened up about three football fields. There's Pancho as the leader. He did pit under that long caution flag, but he got out before both Gordy and Mario and had quite a distance between them on the racetrack after he got out of the pits. Remember earlier this year when Johncock and Andretti were competing here at the Michigan International Speedway, one of the finest races of the season saw those two drivers side by side for a number of laps, and there they are, giving some indications that maybe they're thinking about doing that again.
Running second and third, the leader is Pancho Carter, the winner of the inaugural 500-mile race here at Michigan International Speedway last year. The battle for second and third involving teammates Gordon Johncock and Mario Andretti. Fourth place at this point belongs to Al Unser. Scott Brayton has dropped back to fifth, and Bobby Rahal, the sensational rookie, is running in sixth position. Bobby Rahal from Columbus, Ohio, won the race on the road course at Cleveland and has been also doing very well on the ovals this year. This again, the battle for second position out of turn number four. Gordon Johncock leading Mario Andretti through the tri-oval. 25 laps completed out of 75.
Andretti goes to the inside of Gordy, coming through the tri-oval, entering turn number one, and he gets him right there at the same point where Foyt and Kogan crashed about 15 laps ago. Andretti gets underneath Johncock. Remember, he started in last position.
And Andretti on our radar gun clocked at 213 miles an hour entering turn number one. And Mario Andretti now beginning to close up the distance between himself and the leader, Pancho Carter. Carter comes by the main straightaway here, the main grandstand area, completing the 26th lap. There is Mario Andretti and Gordon Johncock. Fourth place is Al Unser. Fifth belongs to Bobby Rahal. Sixth is Tom Sneva. Seventh is Scott Brayton. Running in eighth position would be Roger Mears. Bobby Rahal and Al Unser are beginning to dice it out for fourth place.
Rahal's without a doubt the surprise of this season. Just about everybody knows that. But I guess the biggest part of that surprise is his ability to perform on the ovals like here at the Michigan International Speedway. Before this season began, there are those who would have said Bobby Rahal will have no business going fast and running up front in an oval track, particularly a high bank racetrack. But Rahal has done very well. He raced here at the 500 earlier in the year, performed quite well, as he did, of course, everybody knows, at the Cleveland race, which he won back in the mid part of the season. And there is Andretti. He has reeled in Pancho Carter.
And down the backstretch, Mario Andretti looks like to be in a position to challenge Carter for the lead. He scoots to the inside, entering turn number three, and Mario Andretti, who started at the rear of the pack, has moved into the lead on the 26th lap. Mario Andretti from Nazareth, Pennsylvania. Here he comes down through the tri-oval. His best finish in an Indianapolis-type car this year has been second place on three different occasions at Phoenix, at Cleveland, and at the Michigan 500. Mario Andretti had high hopes, of course, at the Indy 500, but was eliminated before the green flag fell.
Mario is one of three veteran drivers, gotta call them All-American superstar drivers, who came to this race hoping to end some droughts from victory. Andretti's last win in an IndyCar race was in September of 1980. There is Tom Sneva and Al Unser. Remember, Al Unser just finished going to battle with Bobby Rahal. They're going after fifth position at this point. Sneva appears to be moving in on Al Unser. That's Sneva right behind Al. And there is Gordy Johncock moving around some slower traffic. And Gordy continues to run in third position on the racetrack. Those other two drivers who are trying to end victory droughts, Al Unser, one of those drivers on the screen right there. The last time he won was at Phoenix in 1979. It's been almost 3 years for Al. And A.J. Foyt, who last won at the Poconos in 1981, June of 81. Those three drivers had hoped to end those long victory dry spells. And Freddie and Al Unser still have a chance, but certainly Foyt's chances are over.
And a battle for third position now, as Gordon Johncock and Bobby Rahal are going at it. Gordon Johncock in the STP Wildcat number 20, the red and blue car. leading Bobby Rahal out of turn number two. Rahal moving to the outside as they come off of turn number two. Cannot make the pass as he has to get off the accelerator because of the slower car driven by Chip Ganassi. Now they begin to move into turn number three, and right ahead of them is Pancho Carter.
Well, Rahal, you saw the move that he tried to make as he came out of turn number two. He was hoping to drive up into the banking. You can lean on the banking here a little bit. Rick Mears calls it catching. Remember, he won a race in Atlanta about a year ago on ESPN. He said, I just drove into the number three corner and let the banks catch me. Rahal wanted to do that, but the slower car of Chip Ganassi was in his way and he couldn't execute the move.
31 laps have been completed. It is a very overcast day here in Michigan, and there has been considerable fog. That's the reason why the picture may be appearing a little bit dark to you. There was question this morning as if we were going to have a race because the fog was very thick. Bobby Rahal scooting under Gordon Johncock, establishing himself in third position now. And the weather has improved considerably since early this morning, but is still just a little bit foggy and hazy here in southern Michigan.
Well, the joust that we anticipated up front is beginning to shape up there for second, third, and fourth. There is the second place Pancho Carter, the third place Rahal, and fourth place Gordon Johncock.
32 laps have been completed out of 75 in the Detroit News Grand Prix 150, and Dreddy is the leader all the way from last place. ESPN will present coverage of the 1982 Davis Cup semifinals, the USA versus Australia. The singles, Friday, October 1st at 5 a.m. Eastern Time, 2 a.m. Pacific Time, live. The doubles match on Saturday, October 2nd at 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 11 Pacific Time, and the singles Sunday, October 3rd at 5:30 a.m. Eastern Time, 2:30 Pacific Time. That will be in Perth, Australia, the 1982 Davis Cup semifinals. Well, a driver who had hoped to compete here at Michigan International today unfortunately had problems during qualifying yesterday, was not able to go. Johnny Parsons, he has joined us in the broadcast booth, and hello to you, JP.
Hello, Bob. How are you?
The race is shaping up as one controlled by Mario Andretti at this point. First of all, let's discuss what your problem was that prevented you from participating.
Well, I felt the engine seize up a bit on a qualification run yesterday. I shut it off just to play it safe, and we weren't real sure. We didn't go out in the practice session this morning, but as we started the car for the race today, the bottom end of the engine did let go, so we were unable to start.
Johnny, we had a major accident on the ninth lap of this race. Kevin Kogan and A.J. Foyt, were you in a position to see it?
No, I wasn't, Bob. I just heard that the cars got together before they got into the wall, but I didn't see it at all. No, I was in the pit.
Gary Lee is working in the pit area at this time. Gary?
Andretti continues to lead. His car owner, Pat Patrick, standing by working the stopwatch. Apparently, without practice yesterday in this car, everything is working very well to his liking.
He seemed to be doing very well. Now, right now, our concern is Gordy. He seemed to be pushing him and really not handling well. I just hope something doesn't go wrong.
You found a minor leak in Mario's car before the race. What was that problem?
I think it's just a water leak.
So everything is going well now. The concern once again for Gordy.
Pat Patrick, the owner of the STP racing team. Mario Andretti, one of his drivers. Gordon Johncock, the other driver. Andretti is the leader, and Johncock running in fourth place at this time. Johnny, yesterday a lot of rain besides some fog earlier today. Does that cause a problem for the drivers and the cars, for that matter?
Well, it just created the tempo to increase a great deal. We didn't get a lot of practice. We've had to just go out in a few laps, and I guess most of the drivers felt a little pressure from that.
Now, when they run normally aspirated engines, they used to say that it was good to have cool, high humidity. Is that the same with the turbocharged engine?
Oh, yes, it is. The engines like to perform. They produce a little more horsepower, like a jet engine would too, with cooler air, because it cools the engine down.
Your plans for 1983 at this point?
Well, right now, Bob, I'm currently working with a couple of gentlemen on putting a team together for next season. I'm not real sure about what I'm going to do. This is the time of year where everybody negotiates, so it's up in the air for me right now.
We assume that you will be taking part in the sprints and the dirt cars that you have been doing the past few years.
Most definitely. I love to race on the dirt with the midgets and sprints, and race anything as much as I can.
39 laps completed at Michigan International. The leader is Mario Andretti, running in second position, Bobby Rahal. Third place belongs to Tom Sneva. This is the battle for fourth between Gordon Johncock and Al Unser.
Poncho Carter continues to run sixth as we watch Gordon, this year's Indianapolis 500 winner, and Al Unser, a three-time winner himself. Running in seventh position, Scott Brayton. Scott qualified well here today. He was in 11th on the starting grid, and he has been one of the nice, pleasant surprises of this weekend. With the early yacht and Johncock coming very close to making contact with another car coming down. That was Al Unser coming down the backstretch that time. You saw both of them wiggle as they went to lap the slower car of Jerry Sneva. With the early yellow flag, everybody jumped into the pits to top off fuel tanks and also to check the wear on the tires. What that cinches is that everybody's going to have to stop at least one more time because Johnny, 70 to 80 miles is about the distance you can go on a load of fuel, right?
That's what I understand in talking with my chief mechanic, but geez, with this many yellows, I think a lot of guys are getting good mileage, and I think that's why Mario was able to make such a good, strong run to the front and able to keep a lot of boost in the car.
Well, they didn't know if they were going to stop once or twice. On paper, I suppose, if you turn the boost down, you might have been able to get away with just one pit stop. Al Unser darting up behind Gordon Johncock, and Al Unser very hungry to move to the front. Al Unser showing all the signs of wanting to try and get around Gordy and move up perhaps even a little higher in the standings. But repeating again, everybody's going to have to come in at least one more time.
And Poncho Carter is in the pit area for a routine stop. Poncho was one of the early leaders in this race. The crew working on the right side of the car will keep you posted on that pit stop as we continue to watch the action on the racetrack. Here is Poncho Carter getting fuel now. The tires have been changed on the right side of the car. Poncho Carter down off of the blocks, and Al Unser has developed a problem, has dropped to the inside of the racetrack. It looks like it's all over for Al Unser, who is battling Gordon Johncock for fourth place, and the problems continue to plague Al Unser and the Bobby Helen Longhorn Racing Team.
Well, it's always a disappointment. Of course, one of the top runners run out or go out of a race after a long weekend, but certainly for this team. And trailing Al Unser down pit road is another of our front runners, Tom Sneva. This is only a short race. This was supposed to be a sprint, but the attrition is biting into the field very quickly.
Well, it looks like that Tom Sneva has unbuckled as he brings the car down pit road. We'll keep an eye on that. But it looks like that problems are also going to force Tom Sneva out of the race. You can see him climbing out of that Texaco Star right now. So the winner of the Milwaukee 200 earlier this year at State Fair Park, Tom Sneva is out of the race. And Al Unser, who was leading last weekend at Elkhart Lake, finished second, is out of the competition this afternoon.
But Johnny, when you guys were making your preparations for this race, didn't you figure you were going to have to go as fast as you possibly could every lap out there?
Well, not necessarily. We thought without yellows, we might have to run low boost for a while, at least to get to the midway point. And once you're at that midway point, the chief mechanic has an idea of the mileage you're getting, and that'll tell you in turn what to do with the boost gauge.
We have had five leaders in the contest so far. The first eight laps were led by Kevin Cogan. Gordon Johncock led lap number 9, Bobby Rahal led laps 10 and 11, then Poncho Carter led laps 12 through 27, and at that point, Mario Andretti took over the lead, and he is coming into the pit area right now. The leader, Mario Andretti, car number 40, the STP Wildcat, in for a pit stop. We'll watch the stop as he comes to a halt. The crew is poised and ready to go. Tires are being checked all over the car. Looks like they're going to change them on the right side. We'll go down for a further report from Gary Lee.
They are indeed changing the right side tires and the left rear, topping off the 40-gallon fuel cell. Andretti very impatient in the cockpit. The car still up on the pneumatic jacket. It's now down. He's being pushed away.
And the pit stop was 19 seconds for Mario Andretti. That crew always doing a fine job on pit stops, and they have done it again. Mario Andretti roars back into competition. That, of course, will drop him out of the lead, and there goes the leader of the race going by, Bobby Rahal. So Mario Andretti goes a lap down, but remember, Rahal will have to stop at least one more time.
47 laps into a 75-lap race. Looked pretty routine, Johnny Parsons. Do you think that was a planned stop?
Decent stop, yes. They well calculate everything. Jimmy McGee, one of the finest chief mechanics in the business, chiefing that crew.
And now Bobby Rahal comes off of turn number 4, and Bobby Rahal is heading for his pit stop. Here comes the red roofs in March.
Well, the laps go by very quickly in a race like this. It's a 2-mile racetrack. The speeds are well above 190 miles an hour for the entire field, at least the field, the section of it that is competitive. And it's almost hard to believe that we're already more than halfway through this event. We will only go 75 laps. And now we watch carefully as Ray Hall begins to pull out of pit road. Will Andretti get back around before Ray Hall gets back out on the racetrack? Andretti is exiting turn number 4 right now. He is in the trioval. Andretti crosses the start-finish line. He enters turn number 1. They might come out side by side at speed.
It looks like it could be that way. Ray Hall having trouble, looks like, picking up speed out of turn number 2. Here comes Gordon Johncock in. Johncock was briefly the leader, but now he is coming in for a stop. He passes Mike Mosley as Mosley also comes in for a stop. Here is the stop of Gordon Johncock. By the way, that stop by Bobby Ray Hall was quicker than Andretti. It only took Ray Hall 17.7 seconds to get his fuel and change on right side rubber, and it took 20 seconds for Andretti. Bobby Ray Hall flashes by us, is in the lead. Mario Andretti about a straightaway ahead of, or rather behind Bobby Ray Hall, and Gordon Johncock flashes out of the pit area. So Johncock will now fall into third place. Here's the situation. Bobby Ray Hall is the leader, Mario Andretti second, and Gordon Johncock is third. We will return for more live coverage from Michigan International in a moment. We have completed 49 laps.
Back live at Michigan International Speedway, one of the early spectators is Al Unser. Al, you look dejected as the car goes by. What happened?
Burned a piston or something went wrong internally with the engine. One of those malfunctions of the engine department.
You must have some bittersweet feelings knowing this is your last ride with Bobby Hill in the Longhorn stable.
Yes, it is. We wanted to finish today and do well for him and for all the team and for myself, naturally, but we didn't, and that's the way it goes. Racing's not all the uphill. It has some downs to it.
In other sports, we would call you a free agent right now.
That's right. That I am.
Still looking. We'll check back with you later on next year. Thank you, Al.
Thank you.
Al Unser from Albuquerque, New Mexico, is on the sidelines, while this young man from Columbus, Ohio, Bobby Ray Hall, is leading the 150-mile race here. Second place belongs to Gordon Johncock. Shown a lap down in third place is Mario Andretti. Also a lap down in fourth is Jeff Brabham, and in fifth position being shown as Roger Mears.
It's been a topsy-turvy weekend for Jeff Brabham, racing out, of course, George Bignotti stable. They never really got a time turned in yesterday, and Brabham had to start way back there with Mario Andretti. Brabham was officially showing his 25th on the grid, and in the first 10 or 12 laps of the race, Brabham was hanging back, apparently. They had made some changes on the race car. Perhaps he wasn't as confident with the car as he normally is, but he was running at the very end of the pack the first 10 laps or so of the race. After the first series of pit stops, suddenly Jeff Brabham was up near the front, and for the last 15 laps now, Brabham has been turning in one of his finest performances of the year. He's running in a solid fourth position.
So we have completed 54 laps. Mike Mosley leading Poncho Carter here in turn number 3. And for Mike Mosley, he apparently has found a full-time ride as he has taken over that Craco car stereo machine. And word is from Mike that he will have that ride for next year as much as he wants it. And good news, because there are a lot of Mike Mosley fans out there. Mike has not been too active in the past few years, but apparently he will be. Here is Jerry Sneva in car number 86, very, very slowly down the backstretch. Jerry, of course, the brother of Tom Sneva, who is already out of this race.
Well, Jerry is driving the car that has number 86 on it this weekend. This is Gus and Dick Hoffman's car. Of course, Gus and Dick out of the Cincinnati area, to be exact, Loveland, Ohio. Longtime car owners in IndyCar racing. They've been around for quite some time. They did pretty well at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway this year. They were getting ready to move toward the top 10 when they were involved in a crash with rookie Chet Phillip. And Jerry running very slow right now. He's still about 200 yards from the entrance to the pit area, and I don't think he's going to make it all the way around. We may have to go yellow after this one. Jerry Sneva coming to a halt.
If we do, if this car does stall, why, we will, of course, have to bring out the yellow flag. Right now, the car moving very slowly through turn number four. Here is the situation at Michigan International Speedway. We have completed 57 laps. The leader is Bobby Rahal. Running in second position is Gordon Johncock, and the yellow does come out because of the Jerry Sneva car. I'm Bob Jenkins, along with Larry Neuber. In the pit area is Gary Lee covering the event for you here today. We had a bad accident on the ninth lap involving Kevin Kogan and A.J. Foyt. Neither driver injured in that accident seriously, although A.J. Foyt's leg will be checked at the hospital. Kevin Kogan was not injured. Those two drivers were battling for the lead when the accident occurred. Kogan led the first eight laps, then Johncock, Rahal, Pancho Carter, and Mario Andretti also led before Bobby Rahal took over and has been leading now since the 46th lap. Our serial scoring chart shows you the progression of Bobby Rahal, who has been in the top five just about all the 10-lap intervals this afternoon.
Rahal is one of only five drivers to have won on the Indy Trail in the 1982 season. There have been 10 races. Rick Mears has won four. Gordon Johncock, three. Two of them 500s. Bobby Rahal once. Hector Rabake, of course, the surprise winner last week. And Tom Sneva, the fifth winner among the five of the 10 shows we've had so far.
And here is Gary Lee.
Rahal has made his final pit stop. The crew says the fuel load has been topped off. They changed right side rubber and the left rear. He is ready to go the distance, and they are confident the car is running well enough to keep that pace between first and second. Incidentally, normally Bobby is on the radio to his team owner and manager, Jim Truman, but Jim is also a race driver. He is racing this weekend at Caesars Palace out in Las Vegas, so we've changed the crew just a bit so both the owner and the driver can race.
And Jim, one of those watching us in Las Vegas this afternoon, and we salute you. Pancho Carter in for a pit stop. We are under yellow because of a stalled car on the track and debris on the track. We'll be right back. Timing and scoring shows that Mario Andretti did not lose a lap a while ago, as we were previously told. So Rahal, Andretti, and Johncock are on the lead lap. Those are the only three cars on the lead lap. A lap down in fourth position is the number 21 of Jeff Brabham. Well, it's been a very successful season for Gordon Johncock. It's also been a very successful season for Rick Mears, who is already out of this race. We talked to the guys about this year.
Well, I think it's definitely a success. I really can't complain about it. I think Rick's got the point. It's locked up, but I sure wouldn't trade the year with him. No way I'd trade the year with him. We the first half we done real well, you know. It just seemed like everything went our way. But the last four races, we've had gearbox trouble and broken every race.
I'd trade the championship for the Speedway.
So we're saying Indianapolis Motor Speedway victories are that important.
They are very important. They're very important to a career because they continue on throughout your history. Which so do championships, but not quite as much. The Indy is just kind of the highlight, and as far as what it can generate in revenue afterwards is more so than the championship.
Gordon Johncock in car number 20 runs in third position at this point. Ahead of him, Mario Andretti and Bobby Rahal. And we have 13 laps to go, so it's going to be a dash to the finish. All drivers have had their final pit stop, enough fuel in the cars now to make them go the distance. Here comes Gordon Johncock into the pit area. As he came off of turn number four, Johncock suddenly slowing, ducking to the pit area, and the third place car and driver are in for another stop.
Right front tire.
Well, it'll be interesting to see exactly what the problem might be. Johnny Parsons, you saw a right front flatten.
Well, I saw a crew member bring out a right front tire, so that was some indication, maybe not.
Let's go to Gary Lee to find out.
Right now, there is some communication between George Huning, the crew chief, and the driver, Gordy Johncock. He pulled in, pointed to the back of the car, shook his head. There was some conversation about the gauges, and whatever it was, they changed nothing, and he's back on his way. So another Gordy problem may be developing in car number 40. After the last pit stop, Mario Andretti has developed a pushing situation in car 40. He almost came in during that last yellow to change the stagger on the car, hoping to enhance the handling. However, he has decided, since there are only a few laps to go, to stay out there and make a charge at it, and draw back on all the racing savvy he has to drive that ill-handling car.
Gordon Johncock showing a lot of smoke as he pulled out of the pit area onto the racetrack. We'll be seeing if Johncock can get that car up to speed, but he has already lost a lap to the leaders. Here comes the leader, Bobby Rahal, crossing the start-finish line, completing the 63rd lap, and Mario Andretti is running second.
And Gordy Johncock is headed back for pit road. When he came out the last time, when he pulled out under the racetrack, the bottom side of turn number one smoke was coming from the cowling covering the engine department, and it looks like it's terminal. George Huning leans over, looks at Gordy, shakes his head, he assists Gordy in the quick release steering wheel, and Gordy begins to struggle to get himself out of the race car. It's a day. They're checking out the STP number 20 team, but number 40 team car still on the racetrack and running strong.
Gordon Johncock was running in third place in the CART PPG IndyCar World Series going into this event with 1,366 points, but he is out of the competition here this afternoon. Bobby Rahal second in point standings. The winner of the CART PPG IndyCar World Series already wrapping up is Rick Mears, and that is his second consecutive National Driving Championship.
Andretti is in a position that he's been in a couple of times earlier this year. Remember back at the road race at Cleveland, he was following Bobby Rahal, the guy on your screen on the left and the same behind your screen on the right. Late in the race, most of the veteran observers felt, with Rahal leading and Andretti running second, that Andretti was going to use that race savvy that Gary Lee referred to. A lot of people were conceding it was going to be Andretti's race, but Rahal never let up, and he never gave Mario an opportunity to catch him. Also earlier in the year, Andretti was running well here at the Michigan International Speedway when he ducked in for what he hoped to be a minor chassis adjustment, but he got caught in one of those situations on a yellow flag where you have to get in and out of the pits quickly. There was also a mechanical breakdown in the car, one that did not keep him out of the race but did prevent him from stopping, and he was unable to make the pit stop complete to make his chassis change. So Andretti has got to have a lot of things going through his mind right now. He knows that he's not going to intimidate Rahal. Rahal has come to this season with a great deal of confidence, and he looks mighty strong right now, reminding you that Al Unser, Kevin Cogan, Rick Mears, and A.J. Foyt already have been eliminated from this race.
We're sorry to see Gordon Johncock out of the race, but he is with Gary Lee.
Gordon, you had been in the hunt all day long. You pulled in, you pointed to the back. What went wrong in the engine compartment?
Well, I don't know. Just she's not hitting on all eight.
Chance to talk with Rick Mears. He said the track was somewhat slick both yesterday and today. Do you concur?
Well, I think maybe it was. I was working a little better here toward the end than I was the first part of the race.
So as we heard him say earlier, he would rather take that Indy win the national championship, and he'll be back, of course, next year to run for that championship. Thank you, Cody.
Bobby Rahal has less than 10 laps to go, and victory will be his. That car running very smoothly as he goes to the outside to pass Bill Krueger in car number 65. Six laps to go. Pancho Carter coming into the pit area. He was running in fourth position. There's a tremendous amount of steam coming from the back end of that car, and the steering wheel has been removed, indicating that Pancho Carter is out of the race.
When Rahal first exited the pit area after his last pit stop, he was just 3.5 seconds ahead of Andretti. But now he has lengthened that to 7.5 seconds. So Rahal is definitely driving Andretti into the ground. Andretti is losing ground, and maybe that handling problem that Gary Lee sniffed out in reporting down in the pits is holding back Mario. But Bobby Rahal, the most successful rookie in quite some time in Indianapolis car racing, looks like he is headed for victory number two. We just were reported that Rahal may be running as much as 208 miles per hour off of that radar gun just by entering turn number one.
Andretti is apparently quicker down the straightaway, though. We caught him at 210, but remember, that is the speed at the end of the straightaway, and they have to back off slightly for the turns. Bobby Rahal out of the backstretch into turn number three now. This will be three more laps to go when he comes by. The sensational rookie, that's the only term that you can use to describe him, Bobby Rahal, the winner of the road race at Cleveland, Ohio, second in the point standings. He is about to win here at Michigan International Speedway. Mario Andretti running in second position. The season for Bobby Rahal, 18th at Phoenix. He did not compete at Atlanta. He was 11th in the Indy 500, 20th at Milwaukee. He won Cleveland, was third here at Michigan earlier, second at Milwaukee, third at Pocono, 15th at California, third at Road America, and now in the lead at Michigan International Speedway is Mario Andretti in second, flashes down the backstretch.
There's Mike Mosley right behind Mario. We were talking about Mike earlier that this will be Mike's ride, the Graco Car Stereo team for the 1982 season. Also, they will not be fielding Penske cars next year. The Graco people will not. Remember, they came to the season having bought the frontline cars, the real hot setup machines of the 1981 season. They haven't had the success that they had hoped for, and they will be going to marches for 1983. And Maury Crane, the president of Graco, has told Mike Mosley that they hope to run for the championship. They'll enter every race on the trail next year.
The sun begins to shine on the 2-mile track at Michigan International Speedway as Nick Fedoro, the official starter, waves the white flag in the direction of Bobby Rahal in the number 19 Red Roof Ends March. Bobby Rahal, passing a slow car to the low side in turn number one, sets the car in the middle of the speedway. The 18-degree banking, he was clocked on our radar gun at 208 miles an hour. Now on the 5-degree banking of the backstretch, the relatively flat backstretch. Now heading into turn number three on his final lap around this 2-mile track, Bobby Rahal. Now in turn number four, Chip Ganassi very slow to the inside of the racetrack. Here comes Bobby Rahal winning the IndyCar portion of the Detroit News Grand Prix, and the crew is celebrating already.
And I imagine they're celebrating back in Vegas also as team owner Jim Truman, as we look at Mario Andretti coming through the tri-oval after an overnight flight. He comes home in second position. We are commenting to Jim Truman, who'll be running in a Can-Am under 2-liter formula event later this day, we understand, is probably very happy as he watches his driver, Bobby Rahal, one of the graduates of Formula One racing, a man who also has a lot of experience in Formula Atlantic racing. He also is a former winner of the 24 Hours of Daytona. A little bit of experience in Can-Am racing. Comes home with victory number two, the Detroit News Grand Prix for the 1982 racing season.
Johnny Parsons, what do you think of this guy? He has proven himself on road courses and on the ovals this year.
Bobby's an excellent race driver. He's proven that. The guy's real good. He's got good equipment. And those guys work on that car all the time. They study it.
Third place went to Jeff Brabham in car number 21. So second and third place both came from the rear of the starting field. Jeff Brabham did not qualify yesterday, was added to the field as a promoter's option, and he finishes third behind Andretti and this guy, Bobby Rahal, who has already pulled his car into the winner's circle right in front of the main grandstand in the starting line.
I think another indication of the reverence that these drivers hold for the high bank racetracks, particularly the high banks here at Michigan International. Remember after Cleveland when Rahal won, both hands in the air in a victory salute, but there was just a gesture of the right hand gingerly coming off the steering wheel as he came down the start finish line this time to go to victory here in the high banks of Michigan.
You know, his career somewhat reminds me of that of Danny Gaius, who came on as a strong rookie and won a few races. Now, Bobby Rahal in victory lane, receiving congratulations from his crew, and here is Gary Lee.
Kisses, hugs, and look at that big grin. Bobby, we talked yesterday, and the question was, why is this track so difficult for a road racer to get accustomed to?
Well, it's just, you know, it's completely different running up... When you're going this fast, you know, running up right up behind people, it does things you never experience. And so it takes a little bit of time, but the car ran just beautifully. I mean, it handled. And we had a little problem right towards the end. I think the pop-off valve blew or did something, and I was worried about it. And, you know, but luckily it came through for us.
And I understand your owner, Jim Truman, is watching back out in Las Vegas. You want to wave and say hello?
Well, I better get a red roof hat on. But in any event, no, I hope he has as good a luck as we've had here. And I know, you know, he's given me the best crew that you could get. And they've done a tremendous job.
You were in the hunt all day. There was trouble early right in the front of the pack.
Did you at all see what happened between AJ and Kevin?
No, I really didn't. You know, I was so intent on Gordy, who was right in front of me. And all I saw was just all of a sudden I saw a whole bunch of smoke go up and I saw him go into the wall, and luckily Gordy and I were able to get by before they slid down, but it looked bad. I, you know, hope nobody was hurt, but the car just did a fantastic job. The crew, you know, they got me in and out of the pits, and This one is really sweet for me.
Let's remind your fans that you also finished third here in the 500 miler, so you must have taken a liking to Michigan.
Yeah, I do. I like the 150 mile. I like the short races. They're fun because it's flat out all the way. And next year we'll have to try to win a 500, but this is great winning an oval in my first year.
A big grin ear to ear. Our congratulations to Bobby Rahal.
Bobby Rahal started this race in fifth position, qualified yesterday at 201.393. A look at the top eight, showing that Bobby Rahal was the winner of this race. Mario Andretti was second, Jeff Brabham third, Tony Bettenhausen fourth, fifth, Howdy Holmes, sixth, Mike Mosley, seventh was Bill Alsup, and eighth, Roger Mears. Bobby Rahal has won the IndyCar portion of the Detroit News Grand Prix at Michigan International Speedway. Bobby averaged 137.85 miles an hour in his victory here. Mario Andretti wound up second, and he was the only other car on the lead lap. Very bad accident, or so it appeared, early in the race between A.J. Foyt and Kevin Kogan out in turn number one. Luckily, neither driver seriously injured. A.J. Foyt will have his leg checked over to see if it has any break in it. He was limping considerably as he got out of the race car and as he was walking around the hospital area, but apparently no serious injury to A.J. Foyt. But our congratulations to Bobby Rahal.
Bob, I think it's a race that's going to have some far-reaching effects also. Without a doubt, there will be a lot of conversation about that accident in the next couple days, and of course it was also the last time we'll see Al Unser and Bobby Hillen together, at least for the near the present future at least, and possibly the last time for some of these crews to have performed as a team.
A tremendous job by Mario Andretti. Here's Gary Lee.
Mario, with all of your commitments, you're making a career out of starting at the back of the pack as an added starter and charging all the way through. There was a tire problem or a loose problem in the car. Had it not been for that, could you have caught Bobby Rahal?
Well, we'll never know, obviously, but as you probably noticed, I slowed down tremendously on the last, right after my fuel stop, because the set of tires we put on just didn't conform with what we were hoping. In fact, we could have gone with the original set, but I thought we'd try this and be a little stronger when the fuel load was light. Instead, it just backfired on us. I lost like 8 miles an hour a lap. The car was just running so beautiful the first half, and we probably could have easily left the original set on and been a lot better off.
The crew was prepared for a pit stop. Did you call that stop off, or did your crew chief?
Well, we were debating back and forth. There was 15 laps to go, and we said, should we go for it or not? In retrospect, I don't know. I think I might have had more fun if I would have gone for it, because as it was, the last 15 laps, I just barely hung on.
And of course, now you have the fun of watching your son race.
Well, yes, I don't know if it's fun, but I wish him all the best.
Mario Andretti, a drive from the back of the pack to finish second.
A look at the top 12 as we have wrapped up this 150-mile race here at Michigan. The winner, Bobby Rahal, second Andretti, third Jeff Brabham, fourth was Tony Bettenhausen, fifth place in our competition went to Howdy Holmes, sixth was Mike